Hi, everybody. The title of today's lecture is Mammalian Evolution. And basically, before I discuss primate evolution, I want to do a quick review of early geological history. This is really kind of important when trying to understand the evolution of major groups of animals. The earliest evidence of life on Earth seems to come from sedimentary rocks in Greenland that are dated to about 3.8 billion years ago. Fossil evidence of organisms called stromatolites appear shortly thereafter, and they have been found in Australia. This fossil material dates to the earliest geological sequence called the Precambrian Era. The Precambrian Era dates from the very beginning of life on Earth to the start of the Paleozoic Era. I want to make it very clear that there is very little fossil evidence that we have from this Precambrian Era. Following the Precambrian Era, we have the Paleozoic Era, the Mesozoic Era, and the Cenozoic Era. These three eras constitute what we call vertebrate evolutionary history because the vertebrates evolved during this time period. The Paleozoic Era is from 570 million years ago to 225 million years ago. It's divided into six periods. We'll be talking about them shortly, or you can actually see it right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And the Mesozoic Era is divided into three periods, 1, 2, 3, the Triassic, the Jurassic, and the Cretaceous. You should be relatively familiar with this time period. It's from 225 million to 66 million years ago. And then we have this Cenozoic Era, which has two periods, the Tertiary and the Quaternary. The majority of our time in this class is going to be focusing on the Cenozoic, but I just want to briefly talk about Paleozoic and Mesozoic, kind of to put everything into context. During the Paleozoic Era, this is when invertebrates first appear. They appear during the Cambrian period at the very beginning of the Paleozoic. We note that vertebrates appear during the Ordovician period about 500 million years ago. And it's the vertebrate capacity to form bone that accounts for the much more complete fossil record that we have after 500 million years ago. So most of what we know about fossil history is from 500 million years ago to the present. The first vertebrates are thought to resemble modern sea lancelots called amphioxus. It's a small animal that generally inhabits coastal regions, and it has this notochord, this primitive backbone, as well as a dorsal nerve cord. So this is like the first vertebrate organism. There are five main types of vertebrate organisms. We have fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and then, of course, the lovely mammals. There's relatively complete fossil record for most of these five groups, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And the evolutionary relationships between these groups of organisms is also relatively well known. The amphibians, for example, they appear toward the end of the Paleozoic, during the Devonian period. The first fossil evidence of reptiles occurs during the Carboniferous period. During the Paleozoic, we note that South America, Africa, Antarctica, Australia, and India were combined into a single landmass called Gondwanaland. North America, Greenland, Europe, and Asia were also merged into a single landmass called Laurasia. So all the continents were combined into two continental landmasses, Gondwanaland and Laurasia. These two landmasses then united during the Carboniferous and Permian periods, 345,000 to 225 million years ago in the Paleozoic, to form a huge landmass known as Pangea. By the end of the Mesozoic, Pangea had pulled apart and continents were approximately in present-day position. So by the Mesozoic, we see most continents generally in the same position that they are today. There have been movements, but not as extreme as what we see during the Paleozoic and the Mesozoic. And this is Pangea, everything in one big landmass. Okay. During the Mesozoic, reptiles became the dominant land form. Okay. As you probably are well aware, that during the Triassic period, dinosaurs arose. The Jurassic is considered the age of the dinosaurs. And then the Cretaceous, the dinosaurs reached their peak and they went extinct after about 150 million years ago. The first mammals, interestingly, are in fact known not from the Cenozoic, but from the Mesozoic era. The first placental mammals were identified in the late Mesozoic, 70 million years ago. This little rat. Following the extinction of the dinosaurs, there are many vacant ecological niches that were open for the rapid expansion and diversification of these mammals. The Cenozoic was an opportunistic time for mammals, and as a result, it's known as the Age of the Mammals. The mammalian adaptive radiation of the Cenozoic saw the rise of major lineage of all modern mammals. Indeed, mammals along with birds replaced reptiles as the dominant terrestrial vertebrates. So why were these mammals so successful following the demise of the dinosaurs? The most distinctive feature of the mammals is the universal presence of mammary glands, milk-producing mammary glands, as well as their associated suckling behavior. Several characteristics related to learning and general flexibility of behavior are also of prime importance in accounting for the evolution of mammals. To process more information, mammals were selected for larger brains. In particular, the cerebrum became generally enlarged, especially the neocortex. The neocortex controls higher brain function. The neocortex is kind of like the thinking part of the brain. It's the part of the brain that allows you to recognize that there's more than one way to do something. In some mammals, their cerebrum expanded so much that it came to comprise the majority of brain volume. For such a large and complex organ as the brain to develop, a much longer and intense period of growth was required. So slower development can occur internally as well as after birth, internally in terms of internal gestation, and then postnatal growth after individual is born. Other forms, such as birds, fish, reptiles, they incubate their young externally. This is known as oviparity, oviparous, where they lay eggs. Mammals, with very few exceptions, give birth to live young and are referred to as viviparous. Another very important distinctive feature of mammals is seen in their dentition. While living mammals consistently have similarly shaped teeth, see all the teeth here are exactly the same, mammals have differently shaped teeth. All the teeth here are not exactly the same. Mammal reptiles are what we refer to as homodonts. Their teeth are all similarly shaped. Mammals are heterodont. Teeth are shaped differently. Mammals are also very distinct from reptiles in the way that they maintain their body temperature. Mammals are capable of maintaining an internal constant body temperature. They are warm-blooded, and therefore they are referred to as endothermic, and their energy is generated internally through metabolic activity. Reptiles are ectothermic, where they obtain their energy externally from exposure to the sun. That's why you see snakes lying out in the sun. The Cenozoic is the fourth era. Remember, we had the Precambrian, the Paleozoic, the Mesozoic, and now the Cenozoic. The Cenozoic is probably the most important era for this class because it is the era when the primates evolved. The origin of primates is highly debated. It's a very contentious issue in anthropology. There are three primary hypotheses that have been proposed that we regularly see in textbooks to account for the origin of primates. We have the Arboreal Hypothesis, the Visual Predation Theory, and the Angiosperm Theory. The Arboreal Hypothesis of primate origins links major adaptations of early primates to their tree-dwelling habitat. So basically, because primates are arboreal and up in the trees, they developed these adaptations that made them unique from other mammals. This hypothesis was originally proposed by Elliot Smith in 1912 and Wood Jones in 1916. According to this arboreal hypothesis, while placental mammals were adapting to a ground-dwelling lifestyle, the primates found their adaptive niche in the trees. They adapted to this environment by having opposable big toes. This is a characteristic that is not found in other arboreal mammals. The second hypothesis is the visual predation theory. Matt Cartmill in 1972 elaborated on this arboreal hypothesis of Wood Jones, and he referred to it as the visual predation theory. Cartmill argues that the adaptive features of primates, such as an opposable big toe and thumb, binocular vision, stereoscopic vision, flat nails, would not have arisen in a purely arboreal environment. Something else must have been operating in order for primates to develop this suite of characteristics. According to Cartmill, primates have adapted to shrubby forest undergrowth and lower forest tiers of the forest, where they exploited insect prey and other small prey that were captured through stealth. So basically, it was through the stealthy foraging strategy of primates that they developed all the anatomical characteristics that distinguish primates from other mammals. The third hypothesis that has been proposed is known as the angiosperm theory, and this was by Robert Sussman in 1991. And he proposed that the basic primate traits developed in conjunction with the rise of angiosperms. Angiosperms are flowering plants. Flowering plants provide numerous resources such as nectar, seeds, and fruit. And Sussman argues that primate traits rose in response to the demand for fine visual and tactile discrimination. So primates needed to have really adept hands and visual capabilities in order to distinguish when fruit was ripe, whether a flower has been opened. And he argued that it was necessary for feeding on small food items along these terminal branches. So primates evolved in conjunction with angiosperms. So these are the three primary hypotheses that account for the origin of primates.